All right. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us today for today's program, Veterans Records at the National Archives of St. Louis, Understanding the 1973 NPRC Fire and its Impact on Research. Before I hand it over to our speaker today, Eric Kilgore, I've got a couple of housekeeping announcements. First things first, today's presentation is going to be about 40 to 45 minutes long with some time for Q&A at the end. If you have friends, family, anybody who wasn't able to join us live today, you'd like to share the program with later on, it will be up on the Missouri Historical Society YouTube channel within a few days, so keep an eye out for that. Just a warning, we may not be able to get to all of the questions at the end of the session just due to time, but we'll do the best we can. So I think that is, we're all good to go. I'd like to hand it over to Eric, so we can go ahead and get started.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Again, my name is Eric Kilgore. I am an archives specialist with the National Archives and Records Administration. I work primarily with on-site researchers at the National Archives at St. Louis. My main focus is assisting researchers, genealogists, historians, scholars, anyone interested in conducting research at the National Archives and connecting them with the information they need to meet their research goals. This sometimes involves multi-year complex projects with federal agencies, and sometimes it's just somebody wanting to retrace their grandfather's steps through World War II. So it kind of runs the gamut. During the course of this presentation, we'll be looking at the 1973 fire at the Military Personnel Records Center, as it was once called, and the challenges it presents to researching these records almost 50 years later. As a matter of fact, yesterday, July 12th, marked the 49th anniversary of the fire. So next year will be a pretty big milestone for us. And as you'll see, we've made some amazing strides over the years, but the lasting effects of the fire still present challenges to research. So we're going to cover some of that stuff today. Apologies, seem to be having some difficulties. Are you still hearing me okay?
We've got you now.
Sorry. The National Archives serves as our nation's record keeper. Not only do we house and protect America's historical records and documents, we also provide access to the public. The National Archives at St. Louis is co-located with the National Personnel Records Center and houses records of those individuals who served in the military or civilian service from the late 19th century through the mid-1990s, when the service branches and civilian agencies began transitioning to electronic personnel records. In addition, we also house over 140 record groups of what are considered personal data series records. These are records that can be linked to an individual, so like the official military personnel file. So in addition, we have our largest collections are the OMPFs. We also have a lot of different types of records like general court martial records, selective service system records, burial case files, chaplain's files for anybody that served in the Army who was a chaplain, World War II individual deceased personnel files, a lot of different types of records that can be drilled down to the individual level. We'll discuss some of these records in depth as they relate to researching our records later on in the presentation. I'd also like to invite anyone that is interested in doing so to visit our website for more information on these records, and I'll provide that information at the end of the presentation. Our current facility, completed in 2011, has over 473,000 square feet, including 250,000 square feet of that being for record storage. Our shelving is 29 cubic foot boxes high with two levels of catwalk separating the second and third floors. We have a capacity for 2.3 million cubic feet of records on 385,000 shelves and 15 separate climate controlled storage bays. However, the story of this facility and how it came to be started almost 70 years ago. During the Second World War, the United States saw an unprecedented 16.1 million men and women enter service. For comparison, World War I saw about 4.7 million Americans in service. After the war, with no need to maintain troop levels, millions of soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines found them discharged at the convenience of the government. Most found that a pretty welcome occurrence. The government recognized the immediate need for a central repository of service records, mainly for entitlement programs such as the GI Bill, VA entitlements, and things of that nature. In response, the newly formed Department of Defense began to build a facility to house all the personnel files of individuals separated from military service. The six-story building was built by the Army Corps of Engineers. Its simple and economical design allowed for great flexibility in its primary purpose, which was housing records. The plan for the facility at 9700 Page Avenue in St. Louis called for the joint use by the Army, Navy, and Air Force, one building for three individual record centers. This facility was designated the Department of Defense Military Personnel Records Center, or DOD-MPRC, and it was completed in 1955, and soon after the Army, Navy, and Air Force began moving in their records. At 11 minutes after midnight, on Thursday, July 12th, 1973, a local citizen driving home from work spotted flames on the building's sixth floor and pulled over and reported that to the security guard on duty. 19 minutes later, the first fire department arrived on scene and reported heavy smoke and extreme heat on the sixth floor. By 1:05 a.m., the smoke was reported to be so heavy that the source of the fire could not be located. 2 hours later, the intense heat and heavy smoke drove firefighters from the building entirely. They set up a perimeter and poured water on the from snorkel trucks onto the exterior and through broken windows, and it took 2 days before firefighters were once again able to advance on the sixth floor. By that point, the roof had begun to collapse due to the intense heat and stress, and when the fire was finally declared officially extinguished on July 16th, over 40 fire districts had participated in battling the disaster. As soon as the fire was out and it was safe for personnel to enter the building, damage assessment began, focus centered on two major areas, damage to the building and damage to records. While the sixth floor was determined to be beyond repair, core samples of the building revealed that the rest of the structure was sound. The decision was made to remove the sixth floor entirely and cap the remaining floors of the building. Damage to the records on the sixth floor was extensive, with an estimated 79% loss. The rest of the building's holdings suffered minor water damage when water traveled between floors through electrical conduits, pipes, stairs, and escalators. Not long after, an expert from the Library of Congress flew in to provide advice on countering the mold and mildew problem that would grow out of the water-soaked building during the hot and humid St. Louis summer. And despite preventative measures, mold infestation was first spotted on records on July 19th in the Air Force records. And shortly after, it was confirmed in an estimated 1,200 other wet boxes throughout the building. Wet records were loaded into milk crates in an effort to stage them for drying. Here you can see workers retrieving records from the sixth floor. You'll notice that the roof has collapsed and sections have already been removed. The millions of gallons of water used to extinguish the blaze had made its way into the lower levels and required immediate attention to prevent further damage to records. Throughout this time, crews continuously had to squeegee water out of the building as it settled on the lower floors and corridors. This photo, you can see those wet records that were loaded into milk crates to stage them for drying. Some of these crates were sent to the Civilian Personnel Records Center down on Winnebago Street in downtown St. Louis to be loaded into specially constructed racks for drying. Some were sent to McDonnell Douglas Aircraft Corporation to be vacuum dried, and others were sent to a NASA facility in Ohio. The remainder of them stayed on site to get dried out in what became known as Tent City. This ad hoc drying operation was made up of nearly 30 Army tents set up on the lawn and parking lots of the Page facility. Within 2 weeks of the building returning to government control, reference requests from the VA were being answered. 2 weeks after that, requests from a few other government agencies were added. By October 15th, 3 months after the fire, all incoming reference requests were being serviced. In the end, these figures represent the total estimated losses, over 22 million records. In archival terms, that's one of the greatest losses of information, not only in U.S. history, but in modern world history. It's pretty safe to say that, you know, decades, probably centuries from now, historians will still be cursing the 1973 fire at the National Personnel Records Center. However, I mean, some good did come from this. And as the saying goes, lessons were learned. Facility recovery and renovation began immediately and continued into the years that followed the fire. Construction of firewalls to break up the storage spaces began. Freight elevators were made operational by that winter, and sprinkler installation began late the following year. The lack of sprinklers in the building was a focal point of criticism in the months and years following the fire. When the building was constructed, experts generally agreed that more damage could be done to records by water than fire. The Army fully concurred with this since they stored all of their records in metal filing cabinets. The only problem with that is when metal filing cabinets are exposed to intense heat, they become ovens. That was something, unfortunately, that was learned from this. The Navy, however, didn't share that philosophy. So the Navy had sprinklers installed in their storage areas since their records were stored in cardboard boxes. Over the next three decades, improvements to storage areas and an increased emphasis on solid archival principles ensured that surviving records, along with the thousands of new records that were arriving yearly, would remain safe. This is how the building still appears today. It's still at its old location. It's empty right now. There's a few federal tenant agencies that rent space in there, but there's no mass record storage there anymore. But this is how it appeared after the sixth floor was removed. You can see the freight elevator shafts protruding through the roof where they used to open to the sixth floor. The image from Google Earth is taken from the same corner as the iconic photo in the lower right with the snorkel trucks battling the blaze. In the newer photo on the top right, you can see the fortress-shaped Prevadel building, which was added later to accommodate Army Human Resources Command, which has since relocated to Fort Knox. At the time, it made perfect sense since the OMPFs were all stored at that facility for Army Human Resources Command to be there. In 1995, things started evolving. Over two decades after the fire, the National Archives appraisal team recommended that the official military personnel files become permanent. Basically, what that means is agencies have what's called a record schedule. Sometimes records are deemed permanent and kept for posterity. Other times they're deemed not permanent and they'll be destroyed according to that record schedule. Well, in 1995, the National Archives appraisal team recommended that they become permanent, meaning that they would be transferred to the legal custody of the National Archives and kept for public good. In an effort to expand access and to ensure the preservation of the records, NARA, together with the Department of Defense, developed a schedule signed on July 8th, 2004, making the official military personnel files permanent records of the United States. This schedule mandates the legal transfer of records of 1.2 million veterans who served with the United States Navy and Marine Corps. That meant they were open to the public in July of 2005, which was unprecedented up until that point. In addition, 200 OMPFs, what we refer to as PEP files, persons of exceptional prominence. These are records of presidents, members of Congress, Supreme Court, famous military leaders, decorated heroes, celebrity, and other cultural figures who served in the military. These were made public for the first time. So Elvis, Jimi Hendrix, a lot of those people, their military records, even though they didn't meet that 62-year date, were open to the public just because of the public interest. These actions resulted in the establishment of the National Archives at St. Louis, which is a separate entity from the National Personnel Records Center. Basically, to make it as simple terms as possible, the National Archives at St. Louis is in possession of all of those records that the National Archives has taken ownership of, whereas the National Personnel Records Center, they house and facilitate requests for all of those records that have not yet been turned over from the Department of the Defense, if that makes sense. So in November of 2007, National Archives opened up another 6.3 million OMPFs of former military personnel who served in the United States Army, including the Air Corps, Navy, Marine Corps, and Coast Guard. In September of 2009, on the 62nd anniversary of the Air Force, the creation of the Air Force, NARA accepted the first block of Air Force records into its custody. The opening of these records is part of the ongoing transfer of all official military personnel files from the ownership of the service branch that created it, that the person served in, to the legal custody of the National Archives. This happened 62 years after the separation from service. So based on this rolling date of 62 years, all military personnel records will eventually become archival records held in NARA's legal custody and open to the general public. Also in 2009, NARA signed an agreement with the U.S. Office of Personnel Management, making the official personnel folders of certain former federal civilian employees archival. As such, many personnel records of former federal civil servants whose employment ended prior to 1952 would also be open to the public. This unprecedented shift presented the National Archives with a new challenge and one that required some pretty drastic changes. It was determined that the facility at 9700 Page was too old and outdated, and it could not be brought up to the regulatory standards imposed by the Federal Code of Regulation for storing permanent records in a cost-effective manner. It was decided that a new facility would be constructed in North St. Louis County, one that was purpose-built for the safe and permanent storage of this vast collection of paper records. As permanent records of the United States, these historically valuable documents are cared for and preserved by the National Archives at St. Louis and are available for public viewing and reproduction in our research room. In addition, our offsite reference branch also offers reproduction services for a fee for those that are unable to visit the facility. The interior of this facility boasts 15 storage bays, each being three stories high and constructed with fire barriers, isolating them from the adjoining bays. There's a secure storage area for specially protected holdings like those PEP files that we talked about, and other intrinsically valuable documents, and a cold storage area that houses the records that were affected by the 1973 fire. Since those records were also exposed to water while extinguishing the fire, they still contain inactive mold. Therefore, the bays housing those records are kept at a temperature low enough to prevent those spores from activating. Prior to those records being reviewed in the research room, they go through an extensive cleaning process in our preservation department. The mold's cleaned off, the mold remediation, the documents are stabilized. A lot of times they're put into Mylar sleeves to make them stabilized enough to be handled. And after that process takes place, those records are not returned back to those stacks to where they can be recontaminated. They're stored in a new area where those stabilized records are kept. So this is our facility today, which is located at One Archives Drive in North St. Louis County. It's Spanish Lake area, right by 367 and 270. It's 100% climate controlled and equipped with state-of-the-art fire protection systems to ensure the records of our veterans and civil servants are protected and their service and contribution is not forgotten. We're the largest archives outside of the DC area, but the busiest of all National Archives facilities. Besides storing and providing public access to our records, we receive over 5,000 requests per day from veterans and their families for benefits and other service-related claims. Today, almost 50 years later, we're still working to clean and repair the records damaged in the 1973 fire. Our new facility has state-of-the-art preservation lab to assist in this endeavor. For those records that were destroyed, we spent decades reconstructing records from alternate sources to verify service, character of discharge, and in some cases, awards and decorations so that the veterans can get the awards and benefits that they rightly deserve. There's another very important part of this facility that differentiates it from the old location at 9700 Page, which was built strictly for housing records. And that's that this building was purpose-built to have a public interface complete with dedicated research spaces. Excuse me. The research room at the National Archives at St. Louis provides access to textual paper records in addition to certain archival series that are on microfilm. Earlier, I mentioned that the holdings in the National Archives at St. Louis is primarily composed of personal data series records. While at its creation, St. Louis's primary focus was on the official military personnel files, or OMPFs. We've added numerous record series to our holdings over the years. Some were due to a need for alternative documentary sources to reconstruct that records in order to verify service and character of discharge for benefits. Others were needed to verify entitlements, awards, decorations, and still others were accessioned into our holdings due to their intrinsic value and their relation to the other personnel records housed at this facility. So like court martials, IDPFs, the individual deceased personnel files, things of that nature, any of the records that have to do with like military service or even civilian service where it drills down to the individual level. And even though millions of these personnel records were damaged or destroyed along with the information within them, we have the capability in most cases to provide alternate avenues of research for a veteran's service. And while these alternate sources won't provide all of the information lost, they may be helpful in filling in some of those crucial blanks. So to begin, we'll look at a few misconceptions that persist when it comes to researching these records. So earlier in the overview of the National Archives, we looked at the stats related to the 1973 fire and those records affected. Although the fire was almost 50 years ago, it's only been 18 years since the records were made permanent and open to the public. Still, many people think that all of the World War II records were lost in the fire. Thinking back to those statistics on losses provided earlier, 75 to 80% losses is pretty staggering. However, it leaves a 20 to 25% chance that the record you're seeking may still exist. While it's not great, those are not terrible odds, and we're always encouraging people to submit a request to see what's available. Don't just assume that the records were lost. Likewise, you know, we've had people that requested records, you know, in the 80s, times not too far removed from the fire, and they couldn't locate anything. But as the years have gone on, they found other records inside other records and things like that. So that we've found more since the fire. So we always encourage people, if you're not sure, if you maybe requested something 20 years ago, to submit something again, you know, because you never know. And to drill down on those stats a little bit more and provide a better understanding of those numbers, 80% of the Army and Army Air Corps represents soldiers and airmen discharged between November 1st, 1912 and January 1st, 1960. So that covers the entire World War I, World War II, and Korea period, almost up to Vietnam. That 1960 date, you'll say, well, the fire was in 1973. That's because when a person is discharged, the Army doesn't automatically retire that record upon discharge because there's a chance they could re-enlist or be called back into service, something like that. So there's a certain amount of years that goes by before the Army will retire that, or that any of the service branches for that matter will retire those records to the record center. The 75% of the Air Force records affected pertains to personnel discharge September 25th, 1947. To January 1st, 1964. So it's a little later, but there's a little bit of difference in here. So with the Air Force, they were arranged alphabetically. So anybody with a name after Hubbard James E. Is where those records, you start to see the damage and destruction. So if you have an Air Force personnel member that you want to request their records and their name comes before Hubbard, there's a good chance that the record is fine. So again, if you're not sure, if you requested a long time ago, it never hurts to try again. Another common question we get is, aren't official military personnel records classified? While there may be some sensitive material in the OMPFs and other record series that we might have to redact before being reviewed by the public, especially since some of these service members could still be living, the records as a whole are not classified. And ever since 2007, when that Project 62 was signed facilitating the transfer of those OMPFs from the DoD to the National Archives, a veteran's record becomes archival and open to the public. So that means that any member of the public can access those records. So let's go ahead and take a look at some of those. While service members from the different branches will forever argue which branch is the best, there's no debate about the fact that the Department of the Navy kept the absolute best records when it came to their sailors and Marines. Fewer than 3,000 Navy and Marine Corps records were affected by the fire, so the collection is largely complete. In these records, you'll often find photographs or photographic negatives, such as the one shown in this slide. You'll find things like enlistment, training records, duty stations or ships the sailor or Marine were assigned to, awards, disciplinary actions, lots of other interesting information. This particular sailor is Ernest Thompson, who went by Ernie. Ernie is what is referred to as a plank holder from the USS Missouri. He was stationed aboard her at the Brooklyn Naval Yard during her final fitting, and he served on the Missouri all the way through till the end of the war and was present in Tokyo Bay when Japan signed the surrender. Ernie was his rating in the Navy was a water tender first class, and he worked to keep Missouri's boilers online and ready. If you ever visit the USS Missouri at Pearl Harbor, you'll find a plaque at the entrance to the portside engine room in his honor. That was his duty station. And until his passing in 2016, Ernie spent his days volunteering aboard the USS Iowa near his home in Long Beach Harbor. Mr. Thompson's record is a perfect example of what one could expect to find in a Navy OMPF. And this Navy OMPF belongs to a sailor named William Free. You'll notice that the service booklet on the right has fire damage. However, it wasn't damaged by the 1973 fire. William Free served alongside his father, Thomas Free, aboard the Arizona. Sadly, both were killed on the morning of December 7th, 1941. Those black blotches that you can see on the record are actually fuel oil from the Arizona that still seeps out of the hull today. While the service booklets weren't exposed to direct flame or heat, the heat was so intense that the metal fastener in the middle acted as a heat conductor and charred those records. The telegram in the middle, dated December 27th, 1941, so a couple weeks after the attack, is to William's sister, notifying her that both her and her father were missing in action following the Japanese attacks. The service booklet was salvaged from the wreckage of the Arizona in the weeks after the attack. Only about half of the crew's service booklets were recovered from the ship. To that point, Navy OMPFs have two components. The service booklet, like the one pictured, which followed the sailor wherever he went to duty stations or ship or shore, and the jacket, which stayed with the Bureau of Naval Personnel. The idea being that the records were kept on the ship or station, but would periodically be forwarded to the Bureau using carbon copies from the book whenever the ship was in port. So any ship or submarine that was lost at sea would have taken the sailor's service books down with her, and they'll be absent from those service jackets. So that's a question that we get pretty often as well. The Marine Corps, being a department of the Navy, also kept meticulous records that often contain photographs taken at enlistment or periodically at different points through a Marine service. They'll contain information about duty stations, and most importantly, they contain embarkation slips, which chronicle the places they went, the ships they embarked on, or any engagements that they participated in. This particular record is the Marine Corps officer record of Red Sox great Ted Williams, who was a decorated Marine Corps aviator. The document on the right was written on Red Sox stationery. It's from Williams asking for a copy of his service record. Even though Williams was famous prior to his stint in the Marine Corps, his record is no different than those of the Marines he served with due to his notoriety. Williams was as skilled of a pilot as he was a baseball player, and the Marine Corps took advantage of both of those talents, allowing him to compete in baseball expositions during his time in service. Those documents are also in his record. you know, St. Louis being a baseball town, you know, it's something many Americans share, and that's the case for the next Marine we'll see too. We may not have achieved the notoriety that Williams did. He was a pioneer in the ranks of the Marine Corps and called St. Louis home. This is the Marine Corps enlisted OMPF of Charlie Lockett. He was born in 1926 in Indianola, Mississippi. And in 1944, when he lived in St. Louis, Lockett enlisted in the United States Marine Corps, which was a relatively new opportunity for African-Americans since the Marine Corps only began integration in 1941. And that was after an executive order forcing them to do so. I'm not sure if you can make it out, but in the lower left, in the document on the lower right, in the left corner, there's a small section that asks which sports he was qualified for, and Lockett checked baseball and then added sandlot when asked for a school or team affiliation. Lockett and others trained at a segregated camp just outside of Camp Lejeune, known as Montford Point, and they would come to be known as the Montford Point Marines. And many of these men would go on to serve with distinction in some of the Pacific's toughest battles. Charlie Lockett passed away in 2013 and is memorialized in Jefferson Barracks National Cemetery here in St. Louis. So now that you've seen some of the records that were not affected by the fire, we're gonna dive into the fire-related stuff. So beginning the process of researching official military personnel files is the same, regardless whether or not the subject you're researching served during the period that was affected by the fire or the branch that they served in. You simply submit a request form with some basic information, and we start the process of identifying and searching for records. The first step is to perform a search of our database. We refer to it as the registry. As records are retired from the facility to the facility from the DOD, they're entered into this registry. This allows us to search for records in our system, as well as provide a physical location in the stacks for the record. Stacks are what we call the storage bays. After the fire, all of the recovered records were meticulously cataloged and entered into this registry later on. So with a name, a service number, we can instantly perform like a precursory search in order to see what we have. All of the records that survived the fire, all the records that survived the fire but suffered water or fire damage were entered into the registry with a B prefix. As you might guess, the B stands for burned, or B file as we call them. While we're excited anytime we get a registry hit for a B file, we're cautiously optimistic since we don't know exactly what is there until we physically inspect it. That B file could be anything from a pristine, seemingly untouched, complete record to a charred corner of a document with a service number, a name, or some other identifier on it. We just don't know until we get it in our hands. Once we've verified that the record in question matches the information provided by the researcher, these records are sent to our preservation department to be cleaned, stabilized, have any brittle documents placed into Mylar sleeves, protection. And once this process is completed, it can be provided to the researcher in our research room. This, of course, is a best case scenario. What if you don't know a service number of the veteran you're researching, or you submitted a request and there were no records listed in the registry? In most cases, we can help with that too. Our collection of organizational records can be used to gain basic information such as service number to more detailed information on a service person's unit. In the most extreme cases, when records are too brittle to be handled by the public, our preservation department goes to extreme lengths to prevent further loss of information. In fact, after the fire, the information on this particular document would have been irretrievable. However, with modern technology, we're able to use infrared cameras to capture ink through the charred paper to read the information on these documents. In situations like this, the documents or the entire record is digitized and placed back into protective storage to prevent further degradation. The digital images can then be used to fulfill a benefits request or for a researcher to review. So For most researchers that request Army or Air Force records from World War I through the Korean era, the final pay voucher is the most common document available since most of those records were lost in the fire. These records are a separate series. They weren't contained in the official military personnel file. So there is a caveat to this as well. You had to be discharged generally in order to receive one of these. So unfortunately, that means if a veteran was killed in service, they're not going to have a final pay voucher. The only exception to that is if they had a break in service and were discharged before re-enlisting and then ultimately being killed in action or dying in service. While it's surely disappointing to only have this single document, to tell the tale of someone's military service, it's often a great place to start. These documents were created upon separation from service and basically squared the service person's pay account with Uncle Sam. It was their last paycheck and the government's last chance to deduct anything that the service person still owed the government. These records especially were instrumental in reconstructing service following the fire. The fact that the service person received a final pay voucher indicates that they had indeed served, were honorably discharged. It also provided a discharge date, the place they were discharged from, and in some cases, it provides the unit they were discharged from. And it makes it extremely, sometimes this unit info is helpful, but most of the time, at least at the end of World War II, veterans were assigned to separation units for the sole purpose of discharging them. So it makes it extremely difficult to locate them on morning reports. It's the proverbial needle in the haystack. Some of you may recognize the individual listed on this pay voucher above, William J. Garnier, better known as Wild Bill Garnier from Easy Company 506 Parachute Infantry Regiment, or the Band of Brothers. If you're familiar with the HBO miniseries or the book upon which it's based, you may recall that Garnier was wounded during the Battle of the Bulge and lost a leg. In the top left, third row down, you'll see that he was actually discharged in December of 1945. A year after he was wounded, from Thomas England General Hospital in Atlantic City, where he was recovering. So, R files. Like B files, R files are another type of record that were assigned a unique prefix in our registry. Just like the B stands for burned, the R stands for reconstructed. In the years since the fire, NARA has reconstructed a few million R files. While these records are never going to complete the original information that was lost, they'll often contain some very helpful information. It's also common for the final pay voucher to be inside an R file, since it was one of the primary documents used for reconstruction purposes. There may also be documents that were provided by the veteran, obtained from the VA or state offices, that may have documents related to a veteran's service because they registered for state benefits. When the reconstruction process was going on, NARA would reach out to other federal agencies and state agencies to procure any documentation that they could related to the veteran's service. The reconstruction process was usually initiated when the veteran or their dependents filed a claim for benefits. If there was no record, the reconstruction process would begin. In most cases, the R file will contain the request from the veteran or the family member that started the process. And those can also contain some very valuable information. So when we talk about luck, this is definitely one of the lucky ones. This Army OMPF belongs to a friend of mine named Glenn Harrison. Glenn had a connection to Soldiers Memorial as well. In 2019, Glenn was presented the French Legion of Merit at a ceremony held there. This was the reason that I was able to meet Glenn and his family, since they were looking for information about his service to verify his eligibility for the Legion of Merit. They had been told for years that Glenn's record was lost in the fire, probably because in the past, NARA staff had searched Air Force records since Glenn was a pilot. I was able to locate his record in the Army files, and I'll get to that. But as you can see, not only did his record survive the fire, Glenn survived being shot down on his first and 17th mission while flying bombing raids over Europe. His second time being shot down led to him being captured by the Germans and imprisoned in Stalag Luft III, made famous by the film The Great Escape. The document in red is the actual Personnelkarte or personnel card that the Germans created for him when he was captured. You could tell by his photo that he was not in great spirits, but when he saw this photo, when he was looking at his records a few years ago, Glenn mentioned that the fella's nickname for him was Tyrone due to his resemblance to the actor Tyrone Power. The document on the right is his discharge from 1945, and the document on the left is a pretty pristine example of what an enlisted Army OMPF service book looks like. Similar to the Navy and Marine Corps service books, the Army had those as well. Much of the information that you find in them is administrative, similar to Navy and Marine Corps service books. They contain information like pay, disciplinary, medical treatments, etc. However, unlike Navy and Marine Corps, they didn't put photographs in them, so you rarely will ever find those. Glenn was a pilot, and therefore he was an officer, but he had prior enlisted service, which is why he had an enlisted service booklet. And after the war, Glenn stayed in the Army Reserves, which is why his record wasn't at the center when the fire happened. I mentioned Glenn being shot down on his 17th mission and captured by the Germans. Their mission that day was a bombing run over Magdeburg, Germany, shortly after Bombs Away. The formation came under attack by a heavy flak and enemy aircraft, and Glenn's B-17 was sustained major damage. Alexander Lambrecht, the flight engineer who also served as the top turret gunner, alerted the pilots that the engines were on fire and the crew was ordered to bail out. Glenn recounted the harrowing tale about angry German civilians beating him and trying to stab him after he landed in the field, only to be saved by a German patrol sent out to capture the crew. And in later statements, members of the crew said they counted 10 parachutes going out, and some even said they saw Lambrecht bail out. However, he never arrived at the jail where the rest of the crew was being held for interrogation, and he was never heard from or seen again. It was surmised by the crew that given the hostility of the German civilians they encountered, that Lambrecht was most likely killed and his body had hidden to hide what they had done. They also thought they may have treated him more harshly due to his German name and the fact that he spoke fluent German. Unfortunately, Lambrecht's OMPF was destroyed in the 1973 fire, so we'll examine some alternative sources and organizational records that'll help tell his story. This is his VA index card. The VA index was also an invaluable resource for reconstruction and finding information, especially in cases where the service number isn't known. If the OMPF was destroyed in the fire, it's very common for a person or a researcher to not have a service number or some of those details. So if they have a name, a city where the person was born, a date of birth, or combinations of those pieces of information, we can use the VA index to cross-reference and find a match. And if you notice also in the top right-hand corner of that document, there's an XC with some numbers behind it. That is the number that is assigned to Lambrecht's VA XC file. NARA does not have those records for this time period, but that's another resource that you could do. You can actually request that record via FOIA through the Veterans Administration. So that's another helpful avenue. Army and Air Force morning reports have been an invaluable tool as well. The entire collection is on microfilm and was provided to NARA by the Army following the fire. While the morning reports are certainly no substitute for the OMPF, they do provide vital information about a veteran's service. Morning reports provide a daily accounting of a unit's activities, such as location, when they were there, new arrivals, departures, losses, and mission overviews in this case. Each veteran assigned to a particular unit will not appear in every morning report. However, they will appear whenever there's a status change. The image on the left is dated May 16th, 1944. This is the day that Alexander Lambrecht arrived at the 339th Bombardment Squadron. The morning reports, Lambrecht, along with a handful of others, noted that they were assigned 10th of May by transfer from HQ Army Air Force Station 112, Paragraph 1, Special Order 69. Now, if we were researching Lambrecht's entire service, we could request the morning reports of HQ AAF Station 112 from May 10th, and that report would show Lambrecht leaving the unit. You could keep going backwards looking for his name, because anytime he shows up on a morning report, it's due to a status change, an arrival, a departure. You can effectively trace an individual unit by unit, month by month throughout their service. It's easiest if you have a date to start with. In this instance, I knew that Lambrecht and Glenn Harrison were shot down on June 20th, 1944. So all I had to do was look at the morning reports for the 339th bombardment squadron for June 20th to find them. From there, I could backtrack through the morning reports theoretically until the point they enlisted. This could just as easily be done with the information on a discharge or any other document that ties a veteran to a unit. These images on the center and right are the morning report dated June 20th, just over a month after Lambrecht's arrival to the 339th when the B-17 that they were flying in was shot down over Magdeburg, Germany. The mission reports reads, 20th June, bombing mission performed on Magdeburg, Germany, 12 crews, 49 officers, and 72 enlisted men. Took off at 0545, one crew, Lieutenant Horn, aborted as scheduled and returned to base. Approximately 20 enemy fighters encountered, flak heavy and accurate. Battle damage to all ships, but only two out of commission for more than 24 hours. DeBrandis' crew, which included Lambrecht and Harrison, four second lieutenants, two technical sergeants, four staff sergeants, missing in action. Under their names, it reads from duty to missing in action and dropped from squadron roles. So you won't see those guys on the morning reports anymore after that. And while Lambrecht's time of the 339th was short, these morning reports verify a lot of information that would have been lost in the fire. We know his unit, we know when he was shot down, campaigns participated in, and after the war, this information would have been used to verify the date that he died or was presumed dead. Since Lambrecht died in service, there's another avenue of research that we're going to touch on real quick. I know we're running short on time, but it's a pretty invaluable resource. The individual deceased personnel files. We've been in the process of getting these records from the DOD for years now. Currently, we have all the records for servicemen whose last names begin with an A through L. M through Z will be arriving at some point soon. We'll be able to provide access to those as well. But the Army individual deceased personnel files are a record group that is actually part of the records of the Quartermaster General Corps. Since the Quartermaster Corps handled graves registration, the Quartermaster Corps performed this task for all American KIA personnel, regardless of service branch, after the war ended. They were charged with disinterring remains from temporary battlefield cemeteries and bringing them home at the request of the family or interring them in American cemeteries abroad. These records were created anytime the Army had to handle remains, including searching for or identifying them. IDPFs are a tremendous resource when an OMPF is lost in the fire, and in many cases, documents pertaining to the veteran's death or missing in action status would have been in their OMPF. They'll be found in the IDPF. These documents are from Alexander Lambrecht's IDPF, and the one on the left is the War Department telegram informing his mother that Alexander was missing in action in Germany 10 days after his B-17 was shot down. And the letter on the right, dated August 7th, is a letter from the notification branch of the Army's personnel affairs, providing his mother with more information about the details surrounding the incident and a reassurance that a continuing search of land, sea, and air are being conducted to discover the whereabouts of missing personnel. And these records would have been also contained in the OMPF. The left and middle documents are pages from the Army's report of death for Alexander Lambrecht, dated January 24th, 1950. It includes detailed information about the mission, as well as the statements from the crew that were conducted as part of the investigation. Most of the crew had come to the consensus that Lambrecht had most likely been killed by German civilians upon reaching the ground. Lieutenant DeBrandis, the plane's pilot, stated that Lambrecht told him the top turret guns were damaged and the number two and three engines were on fire. He continued that he didn't think Lambrecht was injured and that the waist gunners believed to have seen him leave the plane with a parachute. He finished by saying, due to the treatment we received from German civilians and German land watchers, which was brutal and hostile, we believe that Sergeant Lambrecht had fallen into their hands and was killed. That's my personal belief. Finally, the document on the right, dated January 31st, 1950, states that the attempted recovery of Lambrecht's remains cannot be resolved until further field investigation is conducted. Unfortunately, the crash site was in the Russian zone of occupation, and the letter goes on to state that due to current political climates, the further investigation at this time was impracticable. Alexander Lambrecht's case is still active with the DPAA, or Defense POW MIA Accounting Agency. So that concludes the presentation. I apologize for having to hurry through the end of it. I'd like to thank you for following along, and a big thank you to the folks at Soldiers Memorial for allowing me to share this information with their patrons. I'm happy to take some questions if you have them.
Yeah, thank you so much, Eric. We've got a little bit of time, so I'll give people some time to type in questions in the Q&A bar at the bottom of the Zoom screen. However, I've got a question to start off.
Sure.
So with COVID, how has researching changed at the National Archives in St. Louis?
So it's changed a lot, temporarily, but one of the biggest changes that we've had to grapple with is during the shutdown, the National Personnel Records Center was pretty much operating on a skeleton crew because of social distancing and stuff like that. So the only request that, you know, we talked about, we receive 5,000 requests a day. Many of those are for benefits and things like that. They had to have basically a skeleton crew of people working on those requests. So the requests that were mainly getting answered were medical emergencies, stuff needed for burials, final military honors, stuff like that. We developed a substantial backlog of other requests. So in an effort to eliminate that backlog and get all the veterans taken care of, our actual research room that was purpose-built for this location has kind of been co-opted. So we stood up a reference corps to help facilitate some of those requests to get those veterans taken care of. We understand how important research is, especially to genealogists in the research community, but our records are a little bit different than a lot of the other National Archives facilities in the fact that many of the subjects of our records are still living. And when those guys need benefits and entitlements and things like that, the research kind of has to take a back seat to that. We are still providing access to records, just not in the capacity that we were before. We're appointment only, which we've always been appointment only generally because, you know, if somebody just stops in and wants to look at a record and it happens to be a fire affected record, there's no way we can provide access to it that day. That's usually a process that can take a couple weeks for preservation to work on those records and get them available for handling. The other issue right now to that point is we're not even actually able to provide access to fire related records right now. Our preservation department is tasked with that whole assisting the veterans for benefits and things like that. So it's kind of an all hands on deck for that. So we're not really able to go through and be cleaning the B files and things like that to provide access to those. Now, that being said, our files, all these auxiliary series, Navy, Marine Corps, anything that's not a physically burned record, we can provide access to. Microfilm morning reports, all that. We're still doing most everything we did just in a reduced capacity. And it is temporary. At some point, we will get back to being fully operational. But we're still able to assist most people and help them meet their research goals.
Great. I'm going to check. No questions yet. So I'll just, if anybody has a question, please, now is the time. Go ahead and type that in before we run. Got one more question. I can pull another question out.
Sure.
So from the time of submitting a request to the time of the request being complete, how long is that on average?
So there's a couple different things at work here. So if you want to come on site and look at records in the research room, you submit those requests and we can usually accommodate you within a few days. The exception to that being when we're back to operating normally, you know, if it's a burned record or a B file, it could take weeks sometimes, depending on the attention preservation has to, you know, pay to that record. But, you know, when we're operating normally, we'll have people stop by and say, hey, I'm passing through St. Louis and I wanted to see my grandpa's World War II Navy record. And historically, we were able to make that happen. It's a little bit more difficult for us right now because of our reduced capacity and we're operating on an appointment only basis. Our research seats are usually full each day. So we can't really accommodate walk-ins right now. We're hoping someday to be able to get back to that. But generally, if you submit a request to come in and look at records, we can get you squared away in a couple days. Right now, we've recently transitioned to Eventbrite for research appointments. So you can actually go on Eventbrite and search National Archives at St. Louis and see all the research appointments we have available. And we schedule out 30 days for textual, 90 days on microfilm. That capacity it'll probably reduce some here once we kind of are able to increase our on-site footprint and allow more people in. We just have a few more hoops we have to jump through right now. For folks that want to, that can't visit us and they submit a reference request online, that's going to take a little bit longer just because, again, we're kind of going through that backlog reduction that was accumulated during COVID. But you'll receive a response generally right away that we received your request and that we're answering them in the order received. But it's definitely faster if you come on site.
Gotcha. Okay. Looks like we've got a question in the chat here from Tori. What is the best way to follow up on a burn record request that remains unanswered, even though NARA acknowledges the existence of the record service?
So first off, they've got, you know, we're happy that we have the record. This is, again, falling into the priority level. During COVID, when our workforce was largely shuttered, we were just kind of going through and getting those emergency requests handled. Now we're trying to reduce the backlog of veterans who have benefits requests, and it might not be an emergency, but it could be for, you know, home loan. They might need a wheelchair, you know, something like that. Those types of requests for benefits get prioritized over general research requests. And I get it, you know, as a historian, you know, I want access to my records and I'm anxious to look at that stuff. Again, the biggest thing that differentiates us from a lot of the other archives is a lot of the subjects of our records are still living. So if they require a benefit, that's going to take a priority over somebody wanting the record for historical or genealogical purposes, even if it's a member of the family wanting like their father's record or, you know, something like that. To that point too, people that were requesting those records, a lot of times in order to get them a response, those records, instead of being a complete copy of the record, they were sending out a DD-214 or a discharge document to at least get something into their hands that they could use. We're doing our best to work through everything right now, and you know, just be patient with us. We're doing the best we can. They've acknowledged that we've got the request. We haven't forgotten about you. You know, we try and give status updates when people request them, but just bear with us. And hopefully, you know, we're on the other end of this whole thing, so you should hear something at some point soon.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Eric. That's all the time we have for today, and all the questions we have in the chat. So yeah, thank you again for joining us today, everyone who's tuned in. Just a reminder that this program will be up on the Missouri Historical Society's YouTube channel within a few days. Also, we'd love if you could join us for our next program. It is this Saturday at 11 a.m. We are opening our newest exhibit that was done by our Teens Make History Apprentices. It is titled The Battle at Home, Veteran Homelessness. The teens will also be holding a panel discussion to talk about their time working on the exhibit and everything they've learned. So we'd love if you join us down here in downtown St. Louis at Soldiers Memorial. Thanks so much again, everyone. Hope you have a great day.
Thank you so much.